The Commonwealth is a voluntary association of 54 independent states, working together towards shared goals of democracy, development, and peace. Member countries span six continents and oceans, from Africa to Asia, the Americas, the Caribbean, Europe, and the South Pacific. The Commonwealth is seen as a special family, a family of nations.
St. Vincent and the Grenadines is an island country in the Lesser Antilles. This territory consists of the main island of St. Vincent and the northern two-thirds of the Grenadines, a chain of small islands stretching from St. Vincent to Grenada. 32 gorgeous Caribbean islands, fondly referred to as one destination, St. Vincent is mountainous with lush rainforests and the Soufre volcano, while the Grenadines charm visitors with idyllic beaches, coral reefs, and turquoise lagoons. St. Vincent was originally named Hiruna by the Caribs, meaning the land of the blessed. Explored by Columbus in 1498, prior to 1719, formerly enslaved Africans sought refuge there, either due to shipwreck or after escaping from other islands. They intermarried with the Caribs and became known as Garifuna, or Black Caribs. In 1719, the French gained control of the island and, using enslaved Africans, began cultivating coffee, tobacco, indigo, cotton, and sugar. Following this, the island was alternately claimed by Britain and France and became a British colony by the Treaty of Paris in 1763. In 1773, the island was divided between the Caribs and the British. Led by Chief Joseph Chateauyer, conflict continued until 1796, when General Sir Ralph Abercrombie crushed a revolt stirred up by French radical Victor Hughes. Over 5,000 Caribs were eventually deported to islands in the Gulf of Honduras. From 1763 until independence in 1979, St. Vincent passed through various stages of colonial status under the British. In 1776, a representative assembly was authorized.
Well, those so-called representative assemblies were not really very representative. You had at one time three constituencies in the whole of St. Vincent and Grenadines, and those so-called representatives were planters for the most part. So it was really, they were part of the colonial structure. These were the times when slavery was still going strong. And the concerns of the administration were the maintenance of law and order in a particular well-defined social structure. But particularly after the abolition of slavery and the growth of education, local persons started coming into their own, and as they read and heard about things abroad, they sort of felt that they needed a greater role in their own affairs.
Crown colony government was installed in 1877 and a legislative council created in 1925.
In the 1940s in St. Vincent, there was an agitational movement led by one McIntosh, George McIntosh. He was a druggist. And he did a lot to enlighten the people as to the rights from which they had been deprived. And then, of course, you had the riots before that of the 1935 riots, followed by the Moyne Commission of 1938. And the Moyne Commission was a very enlightened tribunal, so this made recommendations to the British colonial authorities, indicated above all that you needed a greater sense of participation by local people in the governance. So the British Colonial Office devised a more enlightened system of representation.
This agitation also led to universal adult suffrage in 1951.
One of the central themes of the agitation was the restriction of the franchise to those with property or with money qualifications. So that 1951 marks a watershed in the history of St. Vincent and Grenadines and all the colonies which got adult suffrage, because adult suffrage brought with it a new mindset a new cadre of local people willing to challenge colonialism and what it stood for.
Soon the first political party was formed.
So 1951, when the Legislative Council elections were held on an adult universal franchise, that really ushered in the era of modern politics in St. Vincent and Grenadines. And there was one so-called party. It was not really, you know, a strong party structure, but like-minded men, eight of them won their seats. They called themselves the Eighth Army of Liberation. And from that emerged the People's Political Party and later on the St. Vincent Labour Party, which dominated politics right up to the 1970s.
Indeed, the People's Political Party, PPP, was founded in 1952 by Ebenezer Joshua. With roots in the labor movement, the PPP remained in the forefront prior to independence, winning elections from 1957 to 1966. By 1955, the St. Vincent Labor Party was formed under Milton Cato with the support of the middle class. The SVLP dominated politics from the mid-1960s until the mid-1980s. Milton Cato moved from Premier and Chief Minister to the first Prime Minister when he led the country to independence in 1979. The last of the Windward Islands to gain independence, it was a challenging time for St. Vincent.
In the pre-independence era, there was no agitation for republicanism in St. Vincent and Grenadines. Everybody was content to remain under the fold of the British Crown. What the agitation was about was whether St. Vincent was physically ready for independence, given that we had had a volcanic eruption in April of that year. And when independence came, there were several hundred Vincentians living in camps as refugees from the volcano. And the opposition forces felt this was not the right atmosphere in which to have independence, when people living in schools and in church halls. But the government of the day felt that they wanted to get independence. So dutifully, on the 27th of October 1979, we got independence, and elections followed a couple months after that in December 79.
By 1975, the New Democratic Party under Sir James Mitchell was formed. Sir James had served as Premier from 1972 to 1974. Contesting the first national elections in 1979, the NDP won two seats. In 1984, when Milton Cato called an early election, the NDP won nine seats. Sir James Mitchell became the second Prime Minister, and in 1989, the NDP made history.
The NDP under Mr. Mitchell, who had had a very colorful political career from 66 up to that time, he had gone through crises, he had been betrayed, he had seen it all. He had had long periods when he was the only person in the opposition. So he had been, as Dr. Gonzalez would say, forged on the anvil of struggle. So he performed so very well, he and his government, in the first term after the 1984 success, that in 1989 the country rewarded him with all the seats. All 13 seats. Well, by that time we had increased the seats to 15. Everyone. And the party served that 5 years, 1989 to 1994, without any opposition in parliament at all. During those 5 years, when we had no parliamentary opposition, nobody challenged the government in court alleging that their rights had been violated. We were extremely fastidious about the way we conducted national affairs. And Mr. Mitchell, the Prime Minister, he used to drum it into the heads of all his colleagues like a mantra. He said, "Gentlemen, do not take any decision that you cannot live under if you're in the opposition." And that was our watchword.
By 1994, the Unity Labour Party was formed through a merger.
The Unity Labour Party, ULP, is a merger between two political organizations. an old and distinguished political party, the St. Vincent and the Grenadines Labour Party, which led this country to independence in 1979. And a smaller Movement for National Unity, headed by me. We came together in 1994, February, to run for the elections then. It was a coalition, but we were moving towards a merger, and we became one party, the Unity Labour Party, in October 1994.
Since independence, St. Vincent and the Grenadines has been a parliamentary democracy and a constitutional monarchy.
So in our system, the British monarch is the head of state, executing the office through a governor general, who has to act on the advice of the cabinet of ministers, who must be overwhelmingly elected members of parliament. So we have a parliamentary system in which there are constituencies. And in addition to, at the time of independence, we had 13 constituencies. And in addition to the 13 seats, provision is made in the constitution for 6 senators. 4 senators appointed by the Governor General on the advice of the Prime Minister, and 2 senators appointed by the Governor General on the advice of the Leader of the Opposition. Of the 4 government senators, any 2 could be appointed ministers, no more than 2. And as in common with all democracies, the leader of the ruling party after elections is invited to form a government. But all the ministers are appointed on instruments signed by the Governor General. But once appointed, they function as advisors to the Governor General. And that is how the system is broadly set up.
The judicial system is rooted in British common law, but it differs somewhat.
We have a unique judicial system in St. Vincent and Grenadines, and we are part of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court Authority. So St. Vincent and all the other OECS countries, Grenada, St. Lucia, Dominica, Antigua, St. Kitts, Nevis, and the colonies of Montserrat, the BVI, and Anguilla, we all share the same court system, Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court. Judges are transferable from one island to the other. We have the same Court of Appeal, which travels to each territory to hear appeals. Usually they come to St. Vincent 3 times a year. They sit a week each time they come. And then final appeals are taken to the Privy Council, the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council in London. That is roughly our judicial structure.
After winning its first election in 2001, the ULP, now in its 3rd term as the governing party, is led by Dr. Ralph Gonsalves. The opposition NDP is led by Arnim Eustace. In the December 2010 general elections, the ULP won by a slim majority.
The 2010 general elections resulted in a 7-8 seat victory for the Unity Labour Party and a 48-52% of the popular vote. Essentially, if you look from 2001 to 2010, the ULP, whereas they had 13 seats, they ended up with 8 seats, and by virtue of that, the last 4 seats. And they had a popular mandate. In fact, coming out of the 2005 general elections, they had a popular mandate of around 54-55%, and that was reduced to 52%. So really and truly, that the NDP, the New Democratic Party, went on the ascendancy by in terms of seats and popular votes, whereas the ULP declined in terms of seats and popular votes.
Deputy political leader of the NDP, Dr. Godwin Friday, has this to say.
In the current situation where previously the government had a large majority in terms of the seats in the House, the previous 2 elections, the government had 12 seats, and the opposition, my party, had 3 seats. Now, it's much closer in terms of the seats in the parliament and much closer in terms of the popular vote.
In 2009, towards the end of his second term, Dr. Gonzalez made the bold step of advocating for constitutional reform through a referendum.
Our constitution, which we now have, came into being in 1979, following at the time of our political independence, and the government of 2001, the ULP, saw it fit to revise the constitution. So they set up a constitutional review commission, a 25-person commission, which drew representation from a number of popular sectors, workers, farmers, the political parties, the professional associations, and so on and so forth. And persons were on that commission to look at the present constitution and see where it could be revised. That constitution led to the referendum, that constitutional review led to the referendum in 2009.
I'm an anti-colonialist, and I'm for deeper democracy, greater participation by the people in the democratic processes for the state administration. And I had promised the people, we had in the manifesto of 2001 and then again in 2005, that we'll go for constitutional reform involving a series of elements. Among them, to move away from a monarchical system to a homegrown president, not an executive president, but a president who would hold formal powers replacing the governor general, a ceremonial president, to put it in the language which makes the difference between that and an executive presidency. Keeping a strong parliamentary system, greater controls on the state administration, strengthening the independence and quality of the judiciary, strengthening individual rights and freedoms, all of those things were inside of this constitution which we put. We overloaded the constitution, it seems, and the people rejected it.
And we in the opposition, we supported the move towards constitutional reform. In fact, when the motion was brought to the House of Parliament, the leader of the opposition seconded the motion that was moved by the Prime Minister. And for a long time, a lot of the debates that were being held, the meetings that were being held, were being supported by both sides of the House. But as we got down to the final wording of various parts of the Constitution, there were serious issues that we couldn't agree with. And we sought to have the government reconsider its position on those issues, and they didn't. And we made it quite clear that if those issues were not addressed in a way we thought that was more beneficial to the country, that we would not support the constitutional referendum when it was put to the people.
Well, we got 40-odd% of the vote. So you can say that we had a success in that. It's the only country in the region which has been brave enough, the only government bold enough to put this issue to the people. But you had a lot of scare tactics in that referendum. The opposition said that must keep the Queen, because if you don't keep the Queen, the currency would be devalued, because the Queen face would come off the money. And they prepared and distributed thousands of what the new currency would look like, according to them, with Ralph's face on one side and Chavez's face on the next. So they say that gone straight away. The fact that Dominica is a republic, the Commonwealth of Dominica, with the same currency like us, that objective fact didn't matter. They also said that, the Queen ain't do nobody nothing. Why are you troubling she? you know how these things go. But I believe that a new generation of leaders would take up these same issues. there were also a lot of angst directed towards a quest to remove the Privy Council as the final appellate court. We were defeated, but we had done something noble, and I believe we are on the right side of history.
Notwithstanding this, following the 2010 general elections, Dr. Gonsalves continued his legislative agenda.
The parliament has never been as active as it has been under the Unity Labour Party government. Every single month, the parliament meets. In the old days, under the NDP, parliament used to meet with the frequency of the Supreme Soviet under Brezhnev. The parliament in this country over the last 10 years has had holidays only in 1 year. And that's because my side and the opposition conspired against me.
Meanwhile, the opposition NDP has staged several protests in and out of parliament.
The protests fueled by the opposition were centered on protests against two pieces of legislation. But these protests, while the opposition faithful came out in support, they didn't excite and agitate the popular imagination, because they were not bread and butter issues, they were almost esoteric. And when the dust had settled after the initial wave of protests and people realized that the bills against which the agitation was born were not all that bad, and they didn't threaten to do the things which the opponents of the bill had said that the bills would do.
According to Prime Minister Dr. Gonsalves, the opposition's boycott of parliament has not affected governance.
When they don't come to parliament, I get through my work quicker. And the point about it is this. The way we do the laws, matters which we know to be fairly controversial or matters of a very weighty nature, we publish the bills, you know, in the newspapers. And we ask for memoranda. We have been doing that now for over 10 years, since we've been in government in 2001.
For the Speaker of the House, an even greater challenge than protest has been not having a permanent home.
I would love to see a number of standing committees established. But because we are in borrowed space, we share in this place with other people, we can't have those committees established where we can have them meeting at maybe particularly within the parliament. If we have to do that, they have to find some other place where they can meet. And for me, it's not just the best thing. So I believe until we can sort of, we can improve on that, I think we're sort of limited in what we like to do.
Despite the challenges and heavy workload of parliament, the speakers developed an outreach program.
Long gone the days when the deputy speaker just wait for a moment to sit in the chair. The things outside of that he'll get involving. And some of it are behind the scenes, like this one, for instance, where we're educating the young people about parliament and its procedures, and encouraging them to understand that St. Vincent, along with other Caribbean islands, the home where laws are being made, should be granted that level of trust and respect similar to that of the White House in America.
Awarded in the Caribbean Travel and Leisure World's Best 2011 Awards, St. Vincent and the Grenadines has been strengthening itself way beyond its tourism capabilities.
The educational program is part of the core of our poverty reduction program. When we came to government in 2001, only 39% of the people, of the 12-year-olds, the relevant population, were in secondary school. 39%. 61% of the 12-year-olds were outside of secondary school. Most of them, of course, on the streets. The then government had worked out with the World Bank, with some officials from the World Bank, that they would move towards universal secondary education gradually until the year 2030. So we said that by 2005, we will have universal secondary education. People thought we were crazy. Of course, we achieved it, universal secondary education in 2005. And it has continued, and our results are excellent. We have a one laptop per student policy. We have laid out all the laptops for all the primary school students. From September, we are doing for the secondary schools and post-secondary. In September, all the educational institutions are having wireless internet facilities. In addition to all of that, we have computer labs in all the schools. At the learning resource centers all over the country, which we have built. The entire country is being wired. And in the case of the links, wireless. I have students all over the world, not only at the University of West Indies. I have in Mexico, I have in Venezuela, I have in Cuba, I have in the Republic of China, I have in US, I have in Canada, I have in England, I have in France, I have in Italy, I have in Austria, I have in Morocco. I've gotten scholarships even for Libya. I'll send my students, my students are in Malaysia. I send them everywhere. The International Airport Project is vital for the economic development of this country, social advancement too. The project is the largest capital project since conquest and settlement, $600 million, easy. I can't afford to borrow that money. I don't have all that money either. So I establish my own coalition of the Windling, St. Vincent the Grenadines' own coalition of the Windling. And in that coalition, we have Trinidad and Tobago, we have Cuba, Venezuela, Austria, Mexico, Republic of China and Taiwan. Portugal, we have made links to assist us. And what we have done is absolutely remarkable because we don't have flatlands. I had to build it where, this is the only place, really. I have to mow down three mountains, fill three valleys, span a river, move a church and a cemetery, and move and have rebuilt elsewhere 130 middle-income houses. And we are on target.
Also, looking ahead, the government has paid close attention to CARICOM integration.
Our policy is to have the deepest form of integration which the political market can bear. We're supportive of the single market and economy, and we are in the vanguard. And we have been vital in the process.
Pragmatic, resourceful, and creative, Vincentians see their development in this way.
I think, first of all, let me say that St. Vincent de Grenadines has lost a very good opportunity to have had some important changes made in the constitution and the way we do business. Had it not been that the referendum led to defeat of the bill to introduce revision to the Constitution. Because we still are under the 1979 Constitution coming out of colonial times. And that itself has a number of drawbacks in it, which in my view, hamper the functioning of the state and functioning the way people relate to each other.
So we are stuck with the monarchy,
We are stuck with the cabinet system as we know it. We are stuck with the six senators, as all political senators, with no leeway for civil society to come into parliament in that respect. And we are stuck with party politics.
We in the opposition, we have a mandate to bring vigorous opposition to this House, and that the government, having simply had a narrow victory in the last elections, would feel obliged now to pay more attention to the opinions and the perspectives brought to the House and outside in the public debate by the opposition, because we represent, you know, virtually half the population in terms of what was registered in the vote last December.
Well, I'd like to see the actualization of a vision that every single person has ample and equal opportunities to develop themselves individually and collectively. And that goes for clearly in education, in sports, in business, whatever field of endeavor. It's really about the human being at the end of the day.
St. Vincent and the Grenadines, moving ahead as a parliamentary democracy.